Good morning. Good morning. So, little recap from last time. Where we are approaching Einstein's field equations. So we managed to discuss and describe two very important objects. One is the torsion tensor. One is the curvature tensor or Riemann tensor. And both of them are being tensors, are describe intrinsic properties of the space-time, as if you go, there is not any special, or there is not any system, coordinate system in which you can transform this tensor, set them to zero. If this is the case, then they will be zero all the time. If they are different than zero, then they will be different than zero all the time for all frames. This shows you that they are intrinsic properties of space-time. They cannot be kind of canceled out as it was possible to do with the affine connection, for instance. Okay? We went a little bit into details in looking at these objects. Also, with respect to tensor, with respect to torsion, even though we are going to set torsion equal to zero from now on, still, it's important to know what is the nature and the structure of the torsion tensor, because this condition can help us in the computations. Okay? Later on, there will be computations in which we will need to use and recall the fact that we are assuming torsion free. That goes beyond the fact that, you know, it's ijk is equal to kjk, right? This is meaning the same, but knowing the properties of torsion, we also have some additional constraints on the commutation of covariant derivatives. Remember, the torsion is based on, is defined on the commutator of covariant derivatives. So this gives us additional information and constraints on the computations that we can do. Then we have seen the importance of the Riemann tensor, of the curvature tensor, because we have seen that it's associated to accelerations of vectors, okay? Velocity of vectors, where the vector that we use was the proper, was the four velocity, which means that it was related to an acceleration, okay? Which is exactly what gravity gives you an acceleration, right? Because as we said, it looks like a force. It looks like there is a potential acting upon particles, and it looks like a force. And the fact that we can see accelerations is related to the fact that this guy is contains double derivatives of the metric G, right? So we have double derivatives of the metric G, mixture of them, okay? And we have seen that this is a typical signature of gravity that you would expect for gravity, because we have seen that at first order we can set g mu nu equal to the Minkowski matrix plus we have at second order all the other terms. And at first order we have that the derivative of g mu nu is equal to zero. This we can always set it. This was the free-falling object, right? If we are in the frame of a free-falling object, that's the condition. So you see that to perceive gravity, to know that also for a free-falling object, gravity is present there, you need not the first order, but at least the second order. And then with the second order, you can basically understand the fact the presence of a real gravitational field. Okay? Good. And up to this point, we have seen the Riemann tensor, the curvature tensor, just expressed in terms of the affine connection. Okay, so far we have seen only that. So that's very generic. Now what we're going to do is the usual business, torsion free plus metric compatibility. And in that we can use the Christoffel symbols. So that we have an expression which is not anymore for an affine connection which is arbitrary, if you wish. There are theories in which the affine connection is treated as a field, as a free field that can vary, and it enters into the action, okay? In this case, it's given by geometry, and through these two conditions, we link it to the metric. Therefore, we are going to have an explicit expression of the curvature tensor with respect to the metric. Good, let's do that. So let's write down IJKL. So these are the Riemann tensor, but these are the components of the Riemann tensors. They're equal to the K, then we have the affine connection, LJ, minus the derivative with respect to L, IKJ, plus we have the Christoffel symbols combined in this way, I and K. This should be a dummy variable, gamma and gamma, minus, then again, I, L, gamma, dummy variable, gamma, K, and J. That's what we have seen in the last lecture, okay? So that's the Riemann tensor, the curvature tensor in its full glory. Then what we can do is to make a change in our coordinate system and go in the coordinate system in which we have that the affine connection is equal to zero. We can do that. Right? I just said it here. So we go in the free-falling rest frame. And in this case, the affine connection is equal to zero, and we can basically get rid of these two terms. Now you can say, but you are making something specific. That's not very general. Yes, it is general, because this guy, remember, is a tensor, and this property is never going to vanish, because it's true that the connection is equal to zero, but not its derivatives. Because if you move from that position in which you set the affine connection equal to zero by a bit, it's changing, because not anymore in this free-falling frame. And therefore, the derivative in that location is different than zero. Okay? Is has to be super clear. You know that you understood, but if you have like a x and y coordinate, this is the zero. You have a function that clearly has a coordinate, a derivative different than zero, but here is zero. Okay, so that's the case. Good. And then if you want to have the expression for any other frame, you just need to apply the transformation of tensors to the object that we are going to derive. Nothing more than that. Okay, so this is done for convenience. Then what we do, we just specify the Christoffel symbols, and we make it the entire expression explicit. So we have one half, the k, then we have the other parts of the Christoffel symbol, one gamma, the L G gamma J plus the J G L gamma minus the gamma G J L minus one half the L and then all the rest. Okay? I'm not going to copy it here. You understand what I'm doing. I hope to have enough chalk. We are running out. Then you just apply all your multiplications. You see I have this derivative that I need to apply to all the other things that are inside. Then we have, look, we have the derivative of this object times the rest. So I need to apply the multiplication rule for derivatives. It means the first I'm going to have the derivative of this guy times all the rest plus this guy times the derivative of all the rest. Okay? So just product rule I'm going to apply. First I will apply it to this guy, so I will let this object untouched, and then I have the derivative multiplied here. Okay? Therefore I will have like the k, the L G gamma J plus the K the J G L gamma minus the gamma G J L the gamma G I L and then there are the terms that are coming from this side. Okay? I will copy just a few of them because I need to show you the terms are going to cancel. The K G gamma J minus the L G gamma, that's K gamma plus blah, blah, blah. Then we have all of these objects times the derivative of the first term. Plus the k, and then that's g I gamma times all of that. Okay? And of course, we have the same also for the other guy. But look, a fine connection. We have an assumption for the metric compatibility. So for this guy, is going to be equal to zero. Remember that we are at rest frame, therefore we can identify this derivative with the covariant derivative because the affine connection is equal to zero, therefore this guy is equal to zero. Okay? So all the terms that depends, that are multiplied by of the derivative of the metric are going to change, to drop. Not these guys, because this is a double derivative. Therefore, remember, at first order, we have the derivative that is equal to zero. That's the frame in which we went. But there are the other higher order terms with respect to the derivative. Therefore, we have the second derivative that survives. And you see, we have all second order derivatives. But now look why I copied the first, the terms that were remaining from this other expression here. Because we have gamma j, lk, and KL, but the standard derivative commutes, right? Therefore, I can flip these two guys, for instance, and this guy is equal to that guy, but with a minus in front. this guy cancel, take these two guys cancel each other. And boom, we are done with the final expression. I write it here. You can already read it from here, but since I was dropping a few terms here because something is missing here that I didn't copy from there, I will give you the full expression. K, J, G, and gamma minus the K, the gamma, G, J, L minus the L, the J, G, K, gamma plus the L, the gamma, G, J, K. This is our, these are the components of the Riemann tensor. And you see, they all, it's expressed all in terms of second derivatives, second order derivatives, and the metric, GIK. Okay? Then one thing that we can do is, it's very convenient to have it, is to have the Riemann tensor, but where we lowered the first index so that we have all indices on the ground floor. So R, I, J, K, L, which is that just obtained by applying the metric to lower the E index. So we just use another dummy index. And then we have our guy where we are going to lower the higher index, I, J, K, L. And then what we do, we just get the expression that we found before and we plug it into here. And we let our metric operate on all the rest. So we have one half that is coming from there, G I sigma, which is the guy here. And then there is the metric term that is coming from our expression. So that's the metric coming from the bottom line there. Sigma, gamma, and then there are all the other terms within parentheses here. Now look what we have here. We have this guy. Dummy indices is multiplied by one with each other, and this gives us a delta. This gives us a delta, which is gamma and E. That then is going to act on all the objects that are within the parentheses, which are these guys. So I'm basically just going to copy now all these big parentheses, and I'm going to substitute the terms gamma, that is here, with an E. That's it. Therefore, our tensor in the end will look like one half the K the J G L E minus the K the E G J L minus the L the J G, K, E, plus the L, the E, G, J, and K. These expressions are very important, okay? Because when you're going to make explicit computations for the Einstein's fields equation, as we are going to see, this tensor is going to be contained into them, and you need to compute them. You need to evaluate them in an explicit form and link the result to the metric. Okay, so these are very important expressions. Now, symmetries of these objects. If you look at it, you see that there are a lot of flipping of indices. There are always the same indices flipped and applied always to derivatives of double derivatives of the metric, and this gives you already the intuition that there might be symmetries within this object, meaning that we can flip, there might be occasions in which we can flip the indices and we get the same tensor multiplied by minus or multiplied by 1, so itself. Okay? So if we take this expression, we basically found out that the Riemann tensor is symmetric with respect to the last two indices, J, K, L. So if we flip these two guys here, we are going to get exactly the same thing, J, L, K. I flipped the last two. Okay, symmetric, not with respect to all indices, but with respect to the last two indices. I flip them and I get the same. Then if we look at this expression here, we can identify other symmetries. If I take R, I, J, K, L, this is going to flip with pairs of indices. So I get these two guys, and I flip them. So we get R, K, L, I, J. Then we have another symmetry. R, I, J, K, L is equal to minus, so it's anti-symmetric, with respect to the first two indices. R, J, I, K, L. So you see I flipped these two guys here, the first two in this case, which is equal to minus, again, anti-symmetric, with respect to the last two terms, last two indices, minus I, J, L, and K. Okay. Then, having these symmetries that are about this object and this object, we can derive additional symmetries. Or additional, very important expressions. I continue here so that you have them together. Okay, so we just continue, and we have the fact that we can compute there are kind of cyclic expressions, like this one. I already gave you two expressions with a bracket between the indices. You see, E, and then there is a square bracket and the other indices in between. This means that we get this expression, and then we write it with all permutations. So we just make them rotate. So we kind of flip them, like this one is going to go at the back, and this one shift. And then this is going to in front, and the other one shift go in the back. Okay, so that's called cyclic expression. So we have the first one, L, I, J, K, L, which is untouched. And then we make these two guys slide by one point, by one slot, and put the one in front on the back. Plus R, I, K, L, J, and then plus R, E, L, J, and K, and that's all equal to zero. Why? Well, because we have the other symmetries up there, and you see that there are plus and minuses, and by some magic combination, they're going to cancel each other. And by that, it follows that it's also, that we also have a cyclic expression for all the indices. Because you see, this is true for every E, so if you sum up all the terms with an E, you're going to have the same expression. You see that that's coming from that. So the importance of that and of your life is from the fact that here we are dealing with an object. We look how many indices. 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 indices in a 4-dimensional space. It means that this object will be 4^4 elements. And this is 256 elements. Now, would you like to compute all of them one by one? Probably not, right? And so you know that there are all these symmetries, therefore you don't need to compute all of them, you just need to compute 20 of them. Free components because of the symmetries. The symmetries that I gave you above. Okay, so now you understand why it was boring to look minus, plus, etc., flip the indices, but you see why this is extremely important. Because this reduces the number of free parameters, or let's say of, that you have in your tensor. And it reduces it to something that is manageable. Okay, 20 is manageable. 256, it's not manageable. Good. Then continue to work on that. We can get further expressions. One of which is called the Bianchi identity. Which just tells you that the covariant derivative, and now we have another cyclic expression with, I used beta, R, I, J, and A, K, and L. So again, you see this is a cyclic expression, and you see that I'm running over these three indices. One involves a covariant derivative, and the other two, the first two indices of the Riemann tensor. Okay? Kind of look weird because you have, you know, it looks kind of, you know, this beta belongs to here, but R, it's not. But remember that the covariant derivative of a tensor is still a tensor, right? Therefore, you understand that it makes completely sense to apply this sort of way of writing things also if you are combining different terms, because all of them together are a tensor. They are a tensor together. Here you can see better if I write it in explicit form, because we have the beta R I J K L plus, now I'm starting to flip the indices, so this will roll here. Beta will go at the after the J. R I J beta K L plus the J, and continue rolling, B I K L. So that's not bike, okay? This is beta E K L. Okay? So you see, this is a tensor. It's just a tensor based on indices, and then you can apply the cyclic rule in this, in this way. Good. Now, here is the explosion of terms, because now we need to fill in our Riemann tensor and express it in terms of the metric as it's given up there. What do we get? We get a lot of terms. I just show you a couple of lines, but you understand what we are doing. So we are just plugging the Riemann tensor and we are putting it into here. Again, remember that we are setting ourselves for simplicity and comfort, convenience into a free-falling rest frame, in which, in a free-falling frame, in which the other terms where you have the multiplication, the combination of the fine connections are equal to zero. And in that frame, we know that this guy is also, the covariant derivative is also a standard derivative. Okay? Therefore, what we get is the first guy, that now is a d beta. And then we have all the terms associated to the Riemann tensor, the k, the j, g, l, e, minus the k, the e, g, j, l, plus blah, 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 which is the first guy here. Then we have the second guy, plus, again, 1/2. And now we have the derivative with respect to E of the k, the beta, glj minus the k, the j, g beta l, plus blah, 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 blah. And then we have plus 1/2 and the other term. Why I'm not writing all the terms? I don't bother. Because all of this guy is going to be equal to 0. All terms are going to cancel each other. I just show you a couple of them. Look, delta beta ke. Delta e k beta. But remember that the derivatives commute. Therefore, I can reshuffle these derivatives. Ik beta, so it's this guy and this guy. Apply to what? To the metric component LE, component, sorry, LJ, components here, JL. But the metric is symmetric. Therefore, these two guys are the same. Once they apply to the guy outside here. Not within the parentheses, but once they are multiplied with the object outside. And this is going to happen with all the other terms. They just cancel each other. This very important expression is called Bianchi identity. Then, double contraction, we can get this expression and contract it twice. Double contraction of the Bianchi identity. So what do? We double contract it. So you see we have a tensor, we have various indices, and we just contract it twice. So we just apply the metric with LJ, GK beta, and we apply it to, I just write it in this form here without all the terms below. So we have your theta beta, RI, JKL, plus theta E, RJ, beta KL plus delta J L beta IKL. And then you just let this guy act on the terms that are above. And you see that there are going to be contractions. But I need the Ricci tensor, the Ricci scalar first. Sorry guys, I need first to give you something else. Which is very simple, but you need it to compute that, which is the Ricci tensor first, which is a contraction of the Riemann tensor. So we take the Riemann tensor and we contract it once. Therefore, we have JL equal to RK JKL. So the contraction is done on that. So basically, if you want, we can rewrite it as J so we just apply the metric, so we have J K E R E J K L. Then the metric is going to be applied to the guy here. We are going to get a K here. And you see we have this contraction operating. And this guy is simply called the Ricci tensor. And it's symmetric. Because RJL is equal to RLJ. And the symmetry is coming from where? From the symmetries of this guy. I'm not going to do it here because it's boring, but you can just look, you find it in the node, by the way, but you will just see that the symmetry of the Ricci tensor just follows from the symmetries contained in the Riemann tensor. Okay? So, very simple, Ricci tensor, just a contraction of the Riemann tensor. Then, we are not done yet, because we can contract even more to get a scalar, which is called the Ricci scalar. So, we now do what? We contract this guy here. So, we have J, I, J, and we contract our scalar I, J, which is equal to R. Scalar. Okay? Now that I have these other ingredients that I forgot before, we can double contract the Bianchi identity. So we can just continue. You see that there are terms that, for example, this beta is going up, and what we get? KK, repeated contraction, that is going to be linked to what? To the Ricci tensor. But then we have a double contraction, and there are terms that are doubly contracted, I don't know how you say, contracted twice, that is going to give you a scalar, the Ricci scalar. Again, you find all the notes, in the notes you find all the steps, but you understand where this is coming from. No need to bother you with that. Remember that the Bianchi identity was equal to zero, therefore if you contract something that is zero, it's still zero, right? So double contraction must be equal to zero. That gives you this expression, which is quite convenient, as we will see in following lectures, because you're going to have basically the covariant derivatives of the Ricci tensor that is linked to the covariant derivative of the Ricci scalar. Okay? Now, we can work out this object. In which we basically use the metric to raise this guy here, such that we have the covariant derivatives of R, but the covariance derivative now is going to have an E on top. Sorry, we are going to multiply with, so we can re-express it by multiplying this expression with GI, so GIK, GIK, and then we have, the E K, the K R. You see that these two guys are the same? Okay, if you apply the metric to this object, the K is going to pull down and become an E. Why I'm doing that? Because if I do that, I can define a new tensor, which is called the Einstein tensor. So coming from these two expressions, we basically now have the the covariant derivative with respect to K, because now we have K and K, of R I K minus 1/2 R G I K equal to 0. And what one of the passions of mathematicians, giving name to stuff. And we call this guy G I K, which is the Einstein tensor. Why is this tensor so important? Because it's the core of GR. And I will show you that, okay? So now it was a little bit of, you know, mathematical machinery is going on. If you would be pure mathematicians, you would be happy. Oh, symmetry. But since you're a physicist, I also give you, I'm going to give you the meaning of this stuff. But it's extremely important. I mean, all of those objects and all these expressions are extremely important for the derivation of GR and its application, okay? So it might be boring if you wish, but it's super important. So, recap of the last time, we have seen torsion, the Riemann tensor, we have seen how the Riemann tensor was linked, expressed in terms of the affine connection, very generic. Then, by using our two beloved assumptions, torsion-free and affine and metric compatibility, we can express the affine connection as the Christoffel symbol, through the Christoffel symbols, that give us the expression of the Riemann tensor with respect to the metric that we just derived up there, okay? So we just took the expression for the Riemann tensor in its full glory. We then helped ourselves in going in a frame, in a system of coordinates in which we are free-falling. Okay, so we can basically drop the last two terms because they are identically equal to zero. It's not an approximation. They are identically equal to zero. That gave us the following, and I arrived at this expression, and you see how the Riemann tensor, the curvature tensor, is expressed in terms of the metric and double derivatives of the metric. That they do not vanish when you put yourself in a free-falling frame. Okay? And this is the signature of the fact that you are dealing with a real gravitational field. Because remember when we were doing the business, all the stuff related to the equivalence principle, if we are on a rocket, no gravitational field whatsoever, and there is an acceleration, I feel gravity. But now if I compute the Riemann tensor in that location, it's zero because I'm in flat space-time. I feel an acceleration, but it's not given, which looks like gravity, but it's not. It's just given by a weird frame of coordinates and not associated to gravity because the Riemann tensor in that location is zero, okay? So that's a unique condition that you can have to identify a weird coordinate system related to an acceleration of a rocket, the turning of a spaceship or whatever, with a real gravitational field, okay? And all of that is given by the fact that it's related to double derivatives of the metric. Then we lowered the first index, so we just applied the metric once. We get this other expression, which is very convenient for its usage in computations. And then we start to identify symmetries in this guy, and then other symmetries in this other guy. So just flipping indices, as I showed, gives you the fact that the tensor can be symmetric or anti-symmetric according to which index you are flipping. Then based on these symmetries, we can derive other expression. One of which is this one. So you see that the Riemann tensor is symmetric with respect, there is this expression holding for the cyclic expression applied to the last three indices. This other expression, which is all coming from these symmetries together. And you see the happiness of having these symmetries for your tensor, because they are going to tell you that you don't have to deal with 256 terms to compute, but you have to do it only for 20 of them, which is still a lot, okay? But it's better than 256. I think we all agree on that. Then, once we have our tensor, we identify, or Bianchi identified for us this expression, and he realized the fact that if you get the covariant derivative applied to this permutation of indices of the Riemann tensor, you get zero. That's equal to zero. Like here you say, okay, not that interesting, but then you see the interest get down there, okay? Because then what we did, we double contract the Bianchi identity, we got this expression. This expression then can be reshuffled and given in this form. And this object contains a new tensor which covariant derivative is equal to zero. And this is key, because this is the only tensor that has this property beside the metric. Okay? And as we're going to see, this property, the fact that it also is symmetric with respect to the lower two indices, G I J is equal to G J I, and this comes from the symmetries of the metric, right, and of the Riemann tensor. It allows you to build up the Einstein's fields equation, because this guy must be related, which is the guy representing the geometry, the distortion of the space-time, so the geometric part of GR, is going to be related to the source of gravity, which might be matter, which is matter, and energy densities in general. And they are expressed through the energy momentum tensor, which is a symmetric term. And if you want to relate geometry to matter, expressed in terms of the energy momentum tensor, this guy is symmetric. On this object, there must be another symmetric object. Plus what? This guy obeys energy momentum conservation. It means that when you apply the covariant derivative to this guy, this must be equal to zero. But if this is true for the energy momentum tensor, it must be true also for the other guy responsible for geometry, which is this one. Okay? So Einstein used this way of reasoning to put together the equations and then find out the field equations. And then he played with the equations and said, yes, it's true, it works. Then came Hilbert, and Hilbert said, okay, nice, you put together terms, it works. Good for you, good for everybody, but let's try another approach. And he basically kind of rederived the Einstein's field equation through a variational approach. So identified the action associated to a gravitational field, and through the application of the minimization of the action, you know, with the least action principle, he basically reconstructed the equation of motion of the field, which are the Einstein's field equation that we are going to derive. Okay? So if you look at this guy here, this is already associated to the Einstein's field equations in vacuum. Okay? Because there is no matter there. But this is, again, a fast forward. You don't need to understand all what I'm saying now, because we are going into details, into steps later. But here I want to show you why we are making these contractions and this reshuffling of equations, okay? I want to show you how important they are. So remember the guys, Bianchi identity, Ricci tensor, Ricci scalar, Einstein tensor, and the symmetries for your well-being. Good. Now we can have a break. We can resume at 15 past 10. And we will continue with the geodesic equation. And if there is time, I will show you all the implications that also are involving electrodynamics. Okay, 15.